Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick, and this is a video that I really didn't want to make, but the Lord is pressing me to make it. And it's like this, and the Lord even gave me two witnesses. The Lord had spoken to me, and I mentioned this a while back, about taking authority in the church. You know, God has, a contrary to the anarchy that exists in the America today, and contrary to the in the American church, and contrary to the anarchy that exists on YouTube, not everyone is called to be a minister in the ministry. And these anarchists will quote from the Bible, you know, that we're all one in Christ. There's no more slave or free, or bond or free, and rich or poor, and all that. We're all one in Christ. That's true. It's talking about salvation. But in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, as an example, it says that he gave some apostles, some prophets, some pastors, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, on and on and on. So, and then it gives, in like in 1 Timothy, there's requirements to be in the ministry, like the 144,000 witnesses requirements for being, you know, one of the 144,000, all these different texts. So there are people who are elders in the church, officers in the church, who have authority, not from man, but from God. It is true, as I've mentioned before, there are many denominations, you know, who they are self-appointed because they went to school. As an example, I think it's Presbyterian USA. You know, they had the first openly gay man. He left his wife and family and then married another man. Or living, this is before gay marriage, I guess. He was living with another man. And that denomination embraced that and said it's cool, it's great. And that was the first one. And now, you know, they're one of those. They have a, you know, a gay woman that's the head of their group. It's one of those Lutherans or whatever. If I'm getting these denominations wrong, forgive me, whatever. All those old mainline Protestant denominations that are nothing as the founders were. As I said, when I went to the Methodist church when I was in the States, you know, if John Wesley tried to go preach in one of his own churches that he started way back in the 1700s, they wouldn't let him in. Just like the Church of England, the Anglican Church, wouldn't let him in there because he was preaching truth and they kicked him out, even though he was an ordained minister with them. So the same thing is true of the modern-day Methodist Church. If someone went there preaching the truth, they'd run you out on a handrail. You know, the terrors have taken over the field, you know, in these old denominations. That's why we need to come out of them, unless the Lord assigns us there as salt and light, which is a rare case, but true. I know one person that's two different people who are assigned to be an old dead religion to be salt and light. But of course, they also chose to be there. But God wants to, since they chose to be there, God would use them there. Put it that way. Anyway, and so, as a servant of God, as a minister of the living God in His church, you know, I'm always, you know, let me say this. I've heard there was a famous TV preacher, and he made a video and he gave a rebuke to people who mocked the gifts of the Spirit. And then, you know, if you look at that video, which is a mistake to look at the comments, but you see all these people, you know, and they even made a copy of it, entitled it, you know, this guy, you know, they look for any reason, these devil's children, people who are unsaved, these tares in the church, they look for any reason to attack preachers from, ooh, he made a hand gesture that I think is from the devil in the, why he's speaking, you know, talking about Jesus and his hand gesture doesn't look right to you. Ooh, it's from the devil and all this. And just total paranoid, delusional nonsense. Anyway, we go by the words that people say when they're preaching, the gospel, and then of course the fruit of their ministry and what they do, and the fruit of and just Christians, all Christians, we see the fruit they bear, and we listen to their testimony and things like that. This is how we judge, based on the Word of God, their testimony and the fruit they bear. If whether we would consider that ministry or that person as a brother and sister in Christ. Not that we're judging them, but we say, someone tells me, oh, I'm a Christian, but, you know, I believe all this New Age doctrine. Okay, well, you know, we need to caution, be cautious about that. Anyway, that's not the point of my video. The point of my video is the Lord has told me, you know, that preachers have the authority to rebuke and exhort. Exhort means to pump people up, make, you know, encourage them, comfort them, and then rebuke is to rebuke, to chastise people. And I've, you know, and the Lord has reminded me I have a responsibility and an obligation as His servant, and I will answer to Him for not doing it. And then I said, well, okay, Lord, but you know, these people who are the ones attacking these ministers are the same ones. If the minister says something, they're like, oh, well, you know, what about Christian love? What about Christian love? When they are the ones who are sowing discord and hate and discontent among the brethren, and God knows. So that's the word, I'll get to that. So the Lord gave me two witnesses. Boom. I said, well, Lord, can I have a witness from the scripture? And the Lord gave me one. And I said, well, okay, well, the Bible says, you know, by two or three witnesses. And the Lord gave me a second one immediately. So the first one is in Acts chapter 8, when Peter and John went down there and Simon wanted to buy the power that when he laid hands on people, they'd be baptized in the Holy Spirit, you know, with the evidence of speaking in tongues. He wanted that power. And then Peter said, now Simon was already saved. Peter said to him, you know, let your money perish with you, you know, because I perceive that, you know, you're full of guile and bitterness and all this. And Paul rebuked him and basically, you know, saying like he's going to go to hell. And then, you know, he says back to Peter, you know, and the guy was obviously afraid. Peter rebuked him hard. And then he's like, please pray for me that God will forgive me and all this. And so, you know, it was a correction. And then the second one is also from the book of Acts. It's, and I haven't had time to look this one up. It's when, I didn't look up the other one either, this moment. But when this guy named Bar-Jesus, or Aramaeus, or Bar-Jesus, he was a Jewish guy who was a counselor to the ruler of the same place where Barnabas was from. What's the name of that? I don't know. Let's see. It's not Sardinia. I have to look it up. He was a ruler in that island where they went on their first, when Paul went on his first mission trip with Barnabas. And they went to Cyprus. And they went there. And I'm probably saying that's the wrong place. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to look it up right now while I'm talking to you. So, I looked it up here. Let's look at this second text. It's from Acts chapter 13, the second witness. The first one is Acts chapter 8 with Peter and Simon. They even have a name for it, Simony, you know, bribery in the church. Acts chapter 13, when Paul became Saul. This is when Saul became Paul. They changed his name to Paul after this, what he did. Listen to this. This is what a preacher in the New Testament did. So, let's see. Let's see, it says verse 14, so they am being sent forth by the Holy Ghost, that's Paul, Saul of Tarsus, who is Paul, became Paul in this chapter, started using his Greek name, Paul and Barnabas, and from henceforth they sailed to Cyprus. And when they were at Salamis, they preached the word of God in the synagogues of the Jews, and they had also John to minister. That's John Mark, the book of Mark is John Mark. That's the nephew or cousin or nephew of Barnabas. The same place in the upper room, that was the house of John Mark's mom, the sister or cousin of Barnabas. That's where they were at on the day of Pentecost, the upper room. It was the house of John Mark. John Mark is also the young man who ran naked out of the Garden of Gethsemane when Jesus was arrested in the Gospel of Mark. Let's see. And when they had gone through the isle unto Paphos, they found a certain sorcerer, a false prophet, a Jew whose name was Bar-Jesus, which was with the deputy of the country, Sergius Paulus, a prudent man, who called for Barnabas and Saul and declared to hear the word of God. But Emmaus, the sorcerer, for so it is named by interpretation, withstood them, seeking to turn away the deputy from the faith. Then Saul, who is also called Paul, filled with the Holy Ghost, set his eyes on him and said, O full of all subtlety and all mischief, and thou child of the devil, thou enemy of all things righteousness, wilt thou not cease to pervert the right ways of the Lord? And now behold, the hand of the Lord is upon thee, and thou shalt be blind, not seeing the sun for a season. And immediately there fell on him a mist and a darkness, and he went about seeking some to lead him by the hand. Then the deputy, when he saw what was done, believed, and being astonished at the doctrine of the Lord. Okay. So, in the New Testament, we talk about the love of Christ and all that stuff, which is all true. But the devil's little terrors, and there's plenty of them on YouTube, these little anarchists, children of the devil, who've exalted themselves and tried to put themselves in authority in the church that God did not give them. They try to hide behind. They do the attacking and shooting the fiery darts. And then they attack God's, the men of God. Those men, it says that the qualifications to be a minister is to be a man. It's the first qualification. It's to be a man. Who attack these men of God, and then they hide behind when someone you know, they become emotional from being attacked. They would attack back. Then suddenly it's all about, ooh, what about the love of Christ? Look at this minister. It's supposed to be about the love of Christ. See, that's how they try to form a stumbling block. But listen to the wisdom of the Lord, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah, for the Lord has given his ministers and elders in the church authority to rebuke those little minions who shoot the fiery darts. Now, look, the Lord has been telling me for months to take the authority he gave me. And, you know, the Lord's even warning me. You know, I have to give an account to him for not doing it. So, therefore, I will. I will take authority. I will take authority. So, there's no doubt, by the grace of God, by it's his authority, his spirit, I will take authority. So, it is very biblical to speak a rebuke and even a curse on somebody that's an enemy of the gospel and the enemy of the church, of the cross, and of the servants of God. As I just gave you two witnesses from the Word of God. So all these delusions that people have, these vain imaginations, it's just, oh, God is love, out of balance with what the Bible says, they use as a ruse to attack the true servants of God. As an example, the Lord gave me this before. I want to throw this under because it's in the same topic. Because the problem with lots of people who are supposed to be Christians, they're in a brainwashed mindset. They have the wrong paradigm, as the cool word was to use in business, you know, 10 years ago or whatever it was. Paradigm shift. Let me give you the wrong paradigm. And the Lord asked me this question for me, and then I used it with lots of places. I've made videos about it. Is God's love unconditional? Is God's love unconditional? And people always, in their conditioned response, say God's love is unconditional. And so then the Lord asked me that. That's where I got this from the Lord, in prayer. But the answer is, if God's love is unconditional, why did Jesus come down on the cross? It's not your, you know, you people have made God in their own image. You know, God is happy and smiling and sitting on the throne and laughing at everybody, and he's just a jolly old elf or whatever, something like Santa Claus or some kind of stuff people think. But the Bible says that the foundation of his throne, righteousness and justice, are the foundation of his throne. And God is a just God. So when you go around giving people the Joel Osteen gospel, what's his name? He just died, Robert Schuller, you know, and Norman Vincent Peale, this power of positive thinking and all this stuff, one-sided, out-of-balance gospel. That's why the church in America is asleep and dead, and that's why, because people have had their ears tickled with the gospel of love only, without the fact that God loves the world, yes, and gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe in him shall have everlasting life, and not perish, but have everlasting life. So there is a condition. You must be reconciled to God. So when you tell people, you know, we're all children of God and God loves everybody, when the Bible says we're enemies of God, that's what the Word says. That's why people aren't getting saved, because they're hearing, oh, God is love. God loves everybody. We're all children of God. You know, so, you know, the Muslims are our brother Muslims. The pastor of Hillsong, which I like a lot of the Hillsong music, but it was something about that guy I didn't like, and I even shared a clip on Facebook a few months ago. He said that the God of Islam is the same as the God of the Bible. He's preaching in his church there in Australia. That is a lie from the pit of hell. Anybody, a third grader that can read the gospel, then read the Quranic verses that says God has no son. At the entrance of every mosque in the Middle East, they have the Quran verse, the surah verse up there that says God has no son. God has no son. That's Antichrist. It's not the same God. Allah is not the God of the Bible. By no means. We're all, you know, we're not all God's children. It says we're enemies and strangers of the covenants when you're not saved. We're enemies of God. Strangers. That's why Jesus says when you die, he says one of two things. Enter into your rest, my good and faithful servant, or depart from me. I never knew you. So for all children of God, if every person born in the world was a child of God, how could Jesus say, I never knew you? That doesn't even make sense. Tons of Christians, tons of people watching my videos, they keep spouting this old junk and lies and new age universal love. Universalism is really what it is. There's a church, the universalism, universal There's Unitarianism and Universalism, and now they're combined Universal Unitarianism. You know, and that's what people are teaching, a universal gospel. Everybody's going to heaven. Some of them even say the devil's going to heaven. This is false doctrine. That's why America's not getting saved, because they haven't heard the true gospel. Hardly no one is preaching the real gospel. That's why we need revival. If there's going to be anybody getting saved before the rapture, we need revival. So far as we've said, those who are backsliders, who are already saved, have been, many of them have been called to restoration, especially 2011. You know, I've been in the ministry since 2001. In 2011, there was a sudden surge of church members who were interested in the end times. You know, I thought nobody cared about it but me. And then I found out, you know, now it's tons of people that are involved in it. Praise God. Praise God. Because it's here. That's from God. But if we want people to get saved, they've got to hear the gospel. And, all, you know, when people come on videos, for whatever reason, people love to look at the comments. And then you see all these people throwing stones at God's servants. You think God is not going to make you answer for that? Even if you don't agree with every doctrine that they have, even though they may have some, like they believe in a pre-tribulation rapture, or they don't believe in a pre-tribulation rapture. You're going on there making comments, throwing stones and attacking them, calling them liars, calling them all these kind of things. That's what I'm trying to tell you. God is calling people, and I'm one of them, preachers, to pronounce judgment on you. And I'll do it. That's, you know, there's a double-edged sword when you're dealing with a prophetic ministry. Everybody wants to get a word from the Lord. And that's great. And that's awesome to give that. But sometimes there's a rebuke. Sometimes there's a word of judgment. And all these old, same old, well, that's in the Old Testament. That's not true. I just quoted to you two examples from the New Testament. And there's many more. There's many more. Jesus himself, to the letters to the churches, he told them, repent. He named their good points and their sins, except for the Church of Philadelphia. And it just so happens that every hard-shelled Baptist I know, oh, we're the Church of Philadelphia. Self-righteousness is a killer. Self-righteousness is a killer. So God, the Lord Jesus names the good things and the bad and the sins in all of those churches, except for Philadelphia. And he gives a recall to repentance, to repentance, to repentance to Christians, to repent. And so there's a call, or there's consequences if you don't repent. There is consequences if you do not repent. Jesus even talks about in Matthew chapter 25, he talks about the servant. When the master comes, he finds him drunk and beating his fellow servants. What does the Lord do? He chastises him. He has him beaten. The servants that aren't faithful with the talents they've been given, they're cast into outer darkness. Servants who are cast into outer darkness. Right there in the parables of the Lord Jesus Christ. I caution you not to have the paradigm of the postmodern American and European Christianity, Western Christianity. I caution you to go read the New Testament. Stop trying to figure out if the prophets are talking to you or if the prophets from the Old Testament, that God's going to give you a revelation to figure that out. You got to get the revelation that you got to get right with God yourself first before you can worry about revelations and trying to give all these interpretations from the prophets of the Old Testament. Read yourself in as one of the 144,000, all that stuff. What you need to do is get your personal relationship with the Lord right. And I'm talking about repentance. I'm talking about humility. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. That's why Jesus said, narrow is the way. Straight is the gate, and narrow is the way that leads to salvation. Broad is the road that leads to destruction. And many will find it. Few find the narrow way. And that's by grace through faith in Jesus Christ, the finished work of Christ, brothers and sisters. But before people can get saved, when you go in the modern day, just like people make videos, are you saved, are you saved, and not given the gospel. People, young people today, people under, say, 30 or 40 years old in the United States and in Europe and all these, comfortable cultures, when you say you need to be saved, saved from what? What do they need to be saved from? Why do they need to be saved? They got to know that the building's on fire first, and they got to believe that the building's on fire. They got to know that they're lost and without hope. You can't get found till you know you're lost. Look at the prodigal son. He was sitting in the pig pen, eating the husk. For one thing, pigs are filth and dirty and unclean to Jewish people. You know, it's unkosher. Here he is in filth, you know, out of fellowship under the law from God and from his earthly father, representing God the Father. Here he is eating the pig corn husk, you know, the food for the pigs. And then he came to himself and realized, hey, I'm in a mess here. I'm in dire straits. You know, I'm eating pig food. I'm lost. I need to go back and ask my father to forgive me, to repent and go back and beg my father, let me just be like one of your servants. Just let me be a servant for you, a slave for you. And then, of course, the father received him back as a son. But the son didn't even ask that. He said, can I just come back and be your servant and forgive me of what I've done? And then the father, representing God, exalted him to sonship. See? And so that's where people got to be. They've got to hear the full gospel. And therefore, I'm going to give the full gospel by the grace of God, all those who are truly men of God. And I'm talking to YouTube people, you know, YouTube ministries. If you're a man of God, take that authority that God gave you. Preach the full counsel of God. The full gospel. The counsel of God. And bring it forward. And use the authority that God gave you over these fiery darts. Take up your armor. That's for all Christians. But we as pastors, we have supposed to be experts with that sword of the Spirit. That's why you hear me quoting Bible verses all the time. When Jesus battled Satan, or was tempted by Satan in the wilderness, Satan said something and twisted the word of God, changed the word of God, just like he did with Eve. He said, oh, did God really say, hath God said not to eat the fruit? You know, he challenged, did God really say that? Then Satan did the same thing with Jesus. Oh, if you be the Son of God, turn these stones to bread. See? He kept challenging Jesus. And what did Jesus do? He took the word. It is written. It is written. It is written. That's how to defeat the enemy and his children. That the YouTube is full of his children, and the United States is full of his children. The whole world is full of the devil's children. As Jesus said, if you were children of Abraham, you would do the works of Abraham. If you were children of God, you would know me, Jesus said. But you do the work of your father, the devil. And Jesus said, by your fruit. You talk about false prophets? Jesus said, by your fruit, by their fruit, you will know them. A good tree doesn't, you know, a fig bush doesn't bear thorns. And when I read comments from these, particularly most of them are women, these terrors on YouTube, their comments are thorns. They're accusations, they're accusers of the brethren and attacking people. I don't care about people's reactions, whether it be immature or not. As I've talked about that before, that's not the point. People, I'm warning you in the name of Jesus Christ, I warn you right now by the Spirit of the living God, stop throwing darts at the men of God. I warn you right now in the name of Jesus Christ. May you repent. May you be able. May God give you the opportunity to repent of what you've been doing. May he have mercy on you and give you the opportunity to repent. May he give you the grace to repent. And I pray for you right now in Jesus' name. May you repent. You know, lots of times when people put crazy comments and wicked demonic comments, people say, oh, I'm going to pray for you, like I'm just saying now. But there's also a time, and God knows that time, as he leads us by his Spirit, that people are of a reprobate mind. They need to be rebuked. It's not all just hugging trees and love and flowers and candy. There's a time for the fire to be called down. Like Elijah, it's time to call down fire on the enemies of God. Just like what's going to happen in the tribulation. There are those times. And God is the judge of that. And God uses his servants, the men of God, to do that. I'm going to do God's will. By the grace of God, by his grace sustaining me, by his desire to use me as a vessel, I will do his will. I will finish the race God gave me. And I will not be moved by the slight and cunningness of anybody. And I pray that every true man of God on YouTube that's been rattled and shaken by the devil's children, even myself sometimes, will be strengthened in the inner man to overcome all these fiery darts. For God has great rewards for us. Those who have run in the race for him and serving him, God has great rewards for us. And that's all I can say about it, brothers and sisters. God bless you, all of you guys who are you know, 90% of you or 99% of you brothers and sisters, I don't, you know, I'm not even having hardly anybody attack me. It's for these other channels. It's the Lord is leading me to say this. But you brothers and sisters who are in love, you know, even though if you don't agree, you know what, I know, I don't want to say this. I know personally brothers and sisters who private message me, and they don't agree with the doctrines of other people who do YouTube videos, who are men of God. And I know that, and I'm sure there's people that do it to me, to other people. They go running and telling somebody, oh, well, you know, Brother Patrick said this, and I don't like it. That's nothing. I'll say that's not what I'm talking about, and there's no problem with that. You know, because, but then when you go on somebody's video, you comment in love and say, God bless you, brother, even though you don't agree with them. You know what I'm saying? That's what we're doing as Christians. You know, for non-essential doctrines. Non-essential doctrines, like you don't believe in the rapture, you do believe in a pre-tribulation rapture, you don't. Non-essential doctrines, it does not affect your salvation. But in love, you put a comment to say, God bless you, brother, or you just don't put nothing. You don't agree, you just don't say anything. And that, you know, that's what we're supposed to do as Christians. But there are people who are called as pastors, preachers, elders in the church. You know, and then that's what part of being an under-shepherd is all about to all my fellow servants of God, preachers on YouTube. We are under-shepherds to the great shepherd. And what does a shepherd do? He kills the wolves. He kills the lions and the bears and the giants. That's our job. And people, and the problem with America, with this Jezebel spirit in America and in Europe, neutering men from doing their godly duty. To be manly. Part of being a man is killing the lion and the bear. No matter what popular opinion of homosexuality and emasculating men and women trying to act like men and all that stuff, this ungodly disorder, chaos, and anarchy in the church. And all these effeminate, you know, Catholic priests and all that stuff has got people confused of what it means to be a man and be a woman. This is all from the devil. That's why my word to all men of God in the ministry of the whole world, not just YouTube, stand up. Be the man of God that God called you to. Take up your sword of the Spirit. Take up, you know, your sling and kill the giants. You know, destroy the wolves. Run the wolves and the lions and the bears away from the flock of God. Protect the children of God with the armor that God gave you. By the grace of God, we need to do it and not be afraid. And not be afraid of people's reactions to us. I don't mean being afraid of the wolves. Afraid of, you know, not being liked or whatever. You know, this is the thing, the position that you're in the ministry. You know, you're trying to show love to everybody. And that's what I mentioned. I mentioned Minister Paul many times. You know, when you expose your heart and you're soft-hearted toward people, then people attack you. Then, you know that they're attacking you right in the heart. But so the tension is not becoming hard-hearted to the sheep, but yet being hard-hearted to the wolves. It's very difficult, brothers and sisters. I've been in the ministry for 15 years. It's very hard and difficult to remain open and soft-hearted and with the love of Christ and a pastor's heart to God's people and to the lost who will get saved. At the same time, using a sword and a sling and all that stuff and dealing with the devil's children. You know, so it's hard to switch back and forth. People send you a comment, you misinterpreted that they were being a wolf, and then but they were really a sheep, and they just don't, you know, their comment is written badly. You know, deal with that every day. So I asked you guys, stop throwing stones. And I asked, this is what I'm asking for the support of all every Christian. Not just for me, for anybody on YouTube who is called by God to be a preach, whatever it is, evangelist, whatever. As I mentioned, I mentioned Minister Paul again as a great example to the rest of us. You put your heart out there and then people start stomping all over it. Now that's the devil's people doing that. We know that. You don't have to agree on every doctrine. The Bible doesn't say we have to agree on every doctrine. We can disagree. It doesn't make us not Christians, but it's not ecumenicalism either. You know, it's not this whole, you know, joining the Mormons, Jehovah's Witnesses, all this stuff. But all evangelical born-again Christians, we're brothers and sisters in Christ. And the Bible says, who are we to judge another man's servant? Talking about other preachers and stuff. That's what the Bible says. So we need to have unity in the body. That's why the devil's having such a big time, because all this disunity. We need to have unity in the body of Christ. Now I'm giving you this warning from the Lord. The kid gloves are coming off, is what I'm telling you, because we're in the end times. Times are getting serious. The Lord's putting the squeeze on me, and the Lord is, lighting the fire under me to start taking that authority. And, he's really telling me no, because I've been, backing off of it because, I'm not going to get on here and keep clowning around with the devil's children. I'm not going to waste my time dealing with these people. But sometimes you have to, shoot a stone at them and they run off, hopefully. They just go away, going back to the pit they came from. So I ask every Christian, there's power in prayer. I ask every Christian watching this video to come in agreement with me that we're going to pray that all the people that would not be distracted, that non-believers and new believers, particularly those of you who are mature in the Lord, we want them to have an environment and an atmosphere where they can comment. I'm not going to disable my comments because then people that may say, hey, how did I get saved? They can't put their comment. You know what I'm saying? And then maybe I'm busy. There's many of you, and I think there's many of you who answer people that ask me questions sometimes. And if you're right, I don't say anything. I just let you say, and I look at it, I say, well, that's good advice. I just let you do it. I mean, that's what the church is for. It's not a one-man show, not just I'm a pastor. No, all Christians can be used by God, and that's what we're supposed to do. We're a team. We're all a team, brothers and sisters. Work together. So I ask for earnestly, and this is serious, it's a prayer request to all Christians. Pray that these people that are wolves, like I said, I don't have many attacking me to my face because I know how to use that sword. I don't have no problem with it. But the Lord is telling me to use it against the wolves attacking other ministries. And I'm asking you to all pray in agreement with me that these wolves will go away and then they'll repent. Get saved or go away. That's what I'm asking you to pray and agree with me about. Matter of fact, I better pray right now. Let's pray right now, brothers and sisters. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the Most High God, hallelujah, you who are coming back to judge the living and the dead, the quick and the dead, Lord God, we praise you, Lord God. We praise you, Father, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we just speak and command right now in the middle of storms, peace, be still in the name of Jesus, Lord. As we have authority over all things in this earth, Lord, you gave your people authority over the world, the flesh, and the devil. And we take authority right now. And we command these devil's children to cease. Be still in Jesus' name. Be gone. And be still in Jesus' name. Repent. Be born again. Or go away and leave the children of God alone in Jesus' name. Father, we ask right now in Jesus' name, hallelujah. I speak peace, be still in Jesus' name, over the body of Christ on you too. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Lord. I know that God is going to deal. I know from the Spirit of the living God, God is going to deal swiftly with those who are, as it says, if it's in there, the seven things God hates. One of them is feet that are quick to spread discord among the brethren. And I pray and believe and declare that God will deal swiftly, just like your swift feet, to spread mischief and discord. God will swiftly bring an end to your mischief in the internet. Praise God. I pray that it's through salvation. Let it be through salvation. I pray that it's by salvation and not by any other means. God bless all of you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah. Praise His blessed holy name. God bless you guys.